Thank you, Mike. Our next speaker is Dr. Baker. She specializes in providing mental health services to families during separation and divorce. She's been doing this for the past 20 years. She's also provided expert testimony on many parent-child contact problems throughout Central Texas, and well as provides training seminars to local and state bar associations. I'd like to welcome Dr. Baker. Thank you.
I grew up slowly beside the tides and marshes of the Carolina Sea Island. We lived in a small white house, won by my great-great-grandfather, Winston Shadrach Wingo, in a horseshoe game. There are families who live out their entire lives without a single thing of interest happening to them. I've always envied those families.
Luke, why don't you torment that dog?
My dog! It's my dog!
Tom, you're going to step on him. He's only a pup.
Can't you?
Can't
you?
Child of a beautiful woman, I was also a shrimper's son in love with the shape of boats. As a small boy, I loved to navigate my father's shrimp boat between the sandbars. I suppose Henry Winger would have made a pretty good father. He hadn't been such a violent man. From my mother, I inherited a love of language and an appreciation of nature. She could turn a walk around the island into a voyage of purest discovery. As a child, I thought she was the most extraordinary woman on earth. I wasn't the first son to be wrong about his mother.
Some of this is because my mom's here. depression at its most severe form is like psychological warfare for a child, where their mind serves as the battlefield and the tools of psychological manipulation and exploitation are the weapons used. Victory is only accomplished in these situations when one parent possesses all of the child's love and loyalty. I was in school and college for over 10 years studying psychology and counseling, and never once did I receive a course specifically on the dynamics during divorce for families. Everything I learned about it, I had to learn after I graduated, which is why I make education on this topic a professional priority. My name is Kelley Baker. I've been providing mental health services to children and their families for over 20 years during times of separation and divorce. I am at the core of my being an advocate for children, and it is within that role that I'm speaking with you today. Thank you for being here. Thank you for taking time out of your day that I know is important to hear this lecture. My hope is that at the end of this hour, you leave with information that you did not have before, information that informs your work in some meaningful way. But ultimately, I hope that it serves the most vulnerable people in our society, our children. The definition of parental alienation is a set of strategies used by one parent to undermine and interfere in the child's relationship with the other parent, which results in an unjustified rejection or resistance to the parent. I highlight and I underline the word unjustified because it is a hallmark sign of an alienation case where the resistance to interact with a parent is based on false and irrational beliefs about that parent. I want to make clear that I'm not talking just about parents behaving badly after divorce, although that happens and can be a precursor to the situations that I talk about today. It is the behavior of imposing a false narrative on a child based on and interfering in their genuine loving feelings for another parent that makes parental alienation a form of psychological abuse. When I teach on this topic, I break that definition down into two components. First is the parent's component, which is what do parents do? How do they behave? What do they say? What are the strategies that they use to create an exclusive alignment between themselves and the child? And then the second component is the child component. What does the reaction to these strategies look like? What does an unjustified reaction to a once-loved parent look like? And what makes those behaviors maladaptive and abnormal? So when an alienation case presents itself, when it walks through the doors of my office or a lawyer's office, it's actually going to present itself usually with concerns about the child. So we are going to talk about from the child's perspective first. In 1985, Richard Gardner came up with these 8 characteristics to describe an alienated child. Since that time, there have been many psychological professionals and experts who have done tons of work in this area who have confirmed that there is some combination of these 8 characteristics always present in an alienated child. Additionally, what we've learned is that some combination of these 8 characteristics would also apply to a child in another part of the world. So a child in Belgium will look the same as a child in France, a child in Great Britain, a child in Russia and Croatia, as well as the United States will all show some combination of these 8 characteristics. Some are more common than others. Sometimes they are all 8 present in one child, and other times there is just a few of them present. So I will never forget the first time that I met an alienated boy. He was about 14 years old. He walked in my office. He was extremely confident. He was on a mission. He knew why he was there. This is very unlike most teenagers who come into my therapy office. They come in with their shoulders slumped a little bit, hands in the pocket, their faces are down, and you get the feeling about them that they don't really want to be there, they don't know why they're there, and they certainly are not sure that they want to talk to a complete stranger about their personal problems. But that was not the case with this young man. He came in, he sat down confidently on my sofa, and he was prepared. All I had to do was ask a simple entry question, like, do you know why you're here to speak with me today? And he was off and running. A litany of reasons why he did not want to see his mother, why he should not have to see his mother, why he hated his mother. This is an example of Gardner's first characteristic called a campaign of denigration against the parent. Johnston and Kelley in 2001 described the alienated child and called this characteristic broadcasting. It is the tendency for the child to take any opportunity that they have to vilify a parent, and especially with people who are questioning their decision to not have a relationship with that parent. That litany of reasons that I talked about before, Gardner said, are usually weak and frivolous rationalizations. He said the intensity of their emotion does not match the events they are describing. So for instance, with this young man, his litany of reasons for never wanting to see his mother again included having to sit at the dinner table to have dinner. It included having to do his homework before he could have time on his electronics. It included helping with his younger siblings. All of these things, he said, did not have to happen at his other house. So this is an example from an 8-year-old boy of an emotionally disproportionate reaction. This little boy is reacting to the fact that his mother's 2-hour birthday visit coincided exactly, suspiciously, with the time that his father scheduled friends to come over. This reaction, I'll never talk to you again, all you do is hurt us, you take everything from us. Again, this could have been as simple as a scheduling snafu, where in a normal divorce situation, had the mother gotten the time wrong, or had the father gotten the time wrong, there would have merely been a phone call from the child to the mom saying, hey mom, can we shift our time a little bit because we didn't realize you wanted to do the birthday thing from 2 to 4. But that's not the case. In these cases, it's a reason to completely distance and withdraw and to send hateful messages. The next characteristic, Gardner says, is that their relationships with their parents lack a healthy ambivalence. An alienated child will tell you they have all one good parent and they have all one bad parent. They will also not let that parent out of the bad box once they're there. So there's this lack of forgiveness. There's a lack of an ability to say, oh, we might have some problems that we need to work on in our relationship. And maybe I have done some things wrong. An alienated child, there is no forgiveness. There is no problem solving. They must divide their world into all good and all bad. This is a sign for any seasoned mental health professional that there is something going on. Because we have children who have been legitimately abused and removed from their parents who still want to see a parent or still have some positive memories. So when I get that litany of reasons why the child does not want to see their parent, I will usually say to them, can you tell me one positive experience that you had with your parent? Can you tell me one time that you had fun, one time that she helped you with something? Usually there is an adamant no to that. No, I have never had fun. No, she has never helped me with anything. And no, I have absolutely no positive memories. Now I have a caveat to that because these cases can go on for a long time, and as the lawyer spoke to earlier, you can stay in court for multiple years And so in that case, a child may have had several mental health professionals that they've interviewed with. And this is a red flag question, and they eventually learn that. And so a child that comes to see me that I know they've been in litigation for years, and I know I'm about the fourth or fifth mental health professional they've seen, I might be prepared to hear maybe one good token memory about the parent. But it's not a very deep memory, and it's usually interlaced with more negativity. Yes, that time that she helped me get prepared for my performance. She did a really good job on my makeup, but she really didn't pay attention to me because she went out in the audience and she sat with her boyfriend, and then she just criticized me afterwards. So there's this token good experience that they will learn to share in interviews. Fourth characteristic, Gardner said, there is a lack of remorse and guilt. So this is a text message communication. You can see this child is not holding back and letting this parent know, because she didn't answer a FaceTime call at the time it was scheduled, that she is dead to him. You are dead to me. My old mom is gone. The new one is an evil woman who lies and hurts kids and only cares about finding a man to pay her bills. Well, I'm not sure what 10-year-old, 9-year-old really thinks in those terms. Chances are he was told that by somebody else. I hope I never see you again. Enjoy your vacation with your new family because you're not a part of mine. Wonderful emojis there. And then we have on the other side, God hates people like you and so do I. Goodbye. And skeleton emojis. When I was practicing for this talk, my 11-year-old came into the living room, and he usually knows when I'm practicing. He just come in and leave very quickly. And this time he came in and he turned around and he saw this on the wall, and he stayed and he was looking at it, and he said, what is that? And I said, well, it's from an example from a client that wrote this to their mom. Oh my God, he said that to his mother. If I were to ever say that, I would lose my phone forever. I would never get away with that. And I thought that was a wonderful example of a normalized response to something like this. Like, kids don't talk this way to their parents unless they are encouraged and allowed to do so by the other parent. So where was the consequence for this kid? In actuality, I did inquire about that, and there was no consequence for this child, and there was no insistence that this child apologize to his mother for this. Now, this was in text, but I see this kind of communication verbally between parents when I do assessments. We'll have a child interview. I will see them with both their favorite parent and then with the parent that they are resisting or rejecting. And I have seen this kind of hateful language come out of a child's mouth straight to a parent's face. And I have seen the parent devastated and heaped on my sofa in tears, and not having words to explain what it is like to see this child that less than a year ago they were having fun with sit on a sofa and tell them they never want to see them again or ever have anything to do with them. And so, again, it is a red flag. These are all serious signs of psychological dysfunction in these children. Because kids who even have legitimate reasons to be angry at a parent do not relish in the chance to tell them what they're angry at. The fifth characteristic is the independent thinker phenomena. So Gardner says they will profess that all of these negative feelings and this hatred for the other parent is all their own. They've come up with it all their own. No one else has influenced them. And I can even say, do you think that it made a difference that you heard your mom tell your dad that he was abandoning the family and that he was ruining the family? Do you think that changed the way you thought about your dad? Absolutely not. No. My mom's feelings are just hurt, and she has a right to be hurt, which describes this reflexive support that Gardner talks about. There's a very quick tendency for these kids to jump to the defense of their favored parent, especially if there is even the slightest implication that the favored parent did something wrong. Borrowed scenarios is the seventh characteristic, where they use the same phrases the same stories and have the same beliefs as the favored parent about the other parent. And this usually shows up in interviews. I'll interview parents first, and I will hear from the favored parent. Usually, I will hear a parroting effect in the child to describe the other parent and all the reasons for the rejection. An extension of hatred to the rest of the family, this was mentioned just a minute ago by Mike, it doesn't stop with rejection of one parent. It grows, it mushrooms, it generalizes into other areas of their lives to the point that they are missing a whole branch of their family. This is a pictorial of that, and this is not to imply that these things happen in this order. This picture is only to present a message that it generalizes, it mushrooms, it does not stop. The child may refuse visitation, but still be having some communication with their parent via text or email or even a phone call. Eventually, they will block the parent completely from their devices as well as their social media, and then eventually they will begin to tell the parent that they're uncomfortable with their presence at school events. That might be the one time that the parent gets a communication from the child. It would be a text that said something like, "You make me very nervous and it's going to interfere in my performance tonight, so please don't come to the school for the choir concert tonight." Oh, sorry, I wasn't done with that. I wanted to tell you a story about refusing gifts. So sometimes a targeted parent, it will take them months to get into a court to get help with this. The child's refusing to come, they go hire a lawyer, perhaps they aren't in front of a judge for 6 months or more. Special days go by, and a parent wants to find a way to stay in touch. And so I had a father who it was Easter. He took two little Easter baskets over to the mother's house, and he put them on the doorstep, and he left. And then he emailed her and said, "I left some Easter baskets for the girls on the doorstep." The next morning, he came out to his car. The Easter baskets were sitting on the parking lot beside the door of his car. These girls are 10 and 8. There is no way they could return those Easter baskets on their own without some help from a parent. So we rate the alienation reaction in the child in terms of severity. A mild symptomology could represent just a sensitive child having some issues adjusting to the divorce. How we would know that that's what it is that it would get better. And we would have two parents working together to help the child through the transition. When it's alienation, it doesn't get better. If there's no intervention, that symptomology will eventually go into the moderate level and will eventually end up at the severe level. So look at each of those individually. At a mild reaction, you're going to see clinginess and whininess around the transition time. So usually it's anxiety for younger children and it's anger for older children. 30 minutes, an hour before the other parent is getting there to pick them up, they will begin showing emotional signs of distress. However, at the mild level, once they transition and they're in the care of the other parent, they move pretty quickly into a normal parent-child relationship with that parent, and they have a wonderful time with them while they're there. A targeted parent would know that this was not just normal anxiety related to an adjustment period, because they would begin to hear negative comments made about them through the child. So when the child does make the transition, they'll usually share things that the other parent is saying about them. So that would be a red flag that a parent might need to take some action at that point. A moderate reaction is just going to be more anxiety or more anger. However, whenever they do make the transition, it takes them longer to calm down and move into their normal parent-child relationship. And they also will stop telling people that they had positive times there. So when they transition back to the other parent's house, they will go back to the other home with a lot of complaints and a lot of criticisms, and they won't share any of the good times with that parent. They also begin to find ways to shorten their visits, middle schoolers and high schoolers will usually use extracurricular performances and educational tasks. I have a project I need to complete. I can only do it there. Dad's the only one who can help me. Mom's the only one who can get me dressed, something like that. A severe reaction, again, is the hallmark is a refusal to go. Once the child refuses to transition, they are labeled as having a severe alienation reaction. And again, there's just this tendency for it not to stop there. It just gets worse and moves into other areas. So how does this happen? How does this kind of abnormal, extreme resistance to a parent take hold? We've discussed the child component of the definition, and so now we're going to move to the parental piece. One of the first things to happen for a child whose parents are divorcing is that they must get used to moving between two different homes. This is a huge psychological shift for children, and it affects them on many levels. When I ask kids to draw me a picture of how the divorce affected their life, I usually get some version of this drawing. There's now two homes, and there's one parent in each of those homes. It is the most concrete representation of a monumental change that's happening for them on psychological, emotional, as well as physical and just geographical levels. So my mentors, Karen and Nick Woodall, came up with a concept called the transition bridge to demonstrate how an alienation reaction can begin at the stages that we can begin to see it in the child's transitioning between the homes. So the concept itself represents the psychological, emotional, and the geographical divide that opens up for a child after their parents have divorced. The bridge itself represents the psychological structures and the coping mechanisms that the child uses to help them deal with these changes. The space underneath the bridge and between the parents represents the new psychological space that the child must learn to navigate, where they must let go of one parent and move into the area of the other parent, powering down one attachment and powering up another attachment. When parents get along well and they're amicable, children have enough psychological resources usually to manage this change. When their parents are supportive of each other, their own psychological coping mechanisms will help them manage the logistical changes of what bus do I take home today, what house am I at today, and how do I remember my baseball clothes. And also have enough left over to deal with their own emotions of grief and loss over their parents' divorce. However, when parents are not getting along well, when they're engaged in alienating behaviors, when they're consumed with hatred, bitterness, and jealousy, this area underneath the bridge becomes an abyss, overwhelming abyss of negativity for the child to have to deal with on their own, where they are asked by each parent to support the parent's own worldview about the divorce and the separation, where the child's required to hold two competing and different experiences and is left in a place of not being able to reconcile the internal conflict caused by these behaviors. Each crossing depletes their psychological resources a little bit more, which is represented by pieces of the bridge falling out, making the transition becomes loaded with more and more anxiety, and is harder and harder for them to do. They eventually wear down all of their psychological resources and are emotionally and psychologically exhausted, and they can't make the journey over to the other parent anymore. They have decided that they must take up, in order to survive, they must take up one parent's worldview. They must decide to completely cling to one parent's perception of things, and they cut off the the other parent. So the other parent becomes wrong. We have one parent that's right. And the bridge collapses, signifying the inability to cross. And they have now crossed the tipping point on the continuum, and they have moved into a severely alienated state. So now we'll talk about some of those behaviors that parents engage in. And this is not all of them. I only chose a few because of time, but I did try to choose some that were most common. Bad-mouthing is pretty clear what that is. Calling names, insulting the other parent, criticizing the other parent, demeaning the other parent to the child. And again, I want to stress that this is not just parents who are going through an adjustment phase and learning how to be good divorced parents. This is something that is ongoing. These parents do not change. Their words are loaded with emotional intensity, and there's a frequency to it. It is repetitive. The child hears it every time they are together. Something that's very frustrating for targeted parents is to watch their time with their child slowly dwindle away, to be eroded by many, many different excuses as to why the child can't come over or why the child needs to leave early. However, I do, within my assessments, take a full and complete family narrative so that I can put these behaviors in context. It is not always the case that scheduling an activity that interferes, that occurs on the other parent's time, is an alienating behavior. For instance, if you have children who have been engaged in sporting activities for years, they're 11 years old now, they started when they were five on the gymnastics team. One parent going and signing up the child for the current season of gymnastics and handing the other parent the schedule is not an alienating behavior. It's an extension of the family narrative that has been going on for years. It's something that both the parents have supported the child in for years. Interfering in communication usually occurs through blocking communication on cell phones or iPads. I had one family where dad and stepmom couldn't figure out. They replaced an iPad probably two or three times because they thought there was something wrong with the iPad, and they weren't able to message the children when they were with their mom. And what was really going on, they didn't find out until the third iPad, that she was blocking the communication once they got to her house, and the children didn't know either that she had gotten their iPads and done that. Interfering with symbolic communication really has to do with photographs and representations of the family when they were married, or representations of the other parent with the child. It's amazing to me when I do these home visits where I'll go in and I'll find absolutely no family photos of the last 8 years of these kids' lives. It's almost as if with the divorce some sort of bar was dropped down and life before the divorce didn't exist. But I also work with parents who are trying to do the right thing for their kids, and I teach them to keep memories alive through storytelling. So, for instance, if there's a parent, this happened, this is not an exact story for me, but my son was fishing and he caught this really great catfish, and I watched him take it off the hook, and I said something like, remember that spring break when you learned to get that fish off the hook? You remember it was so hard. Dad helped you, you did it over and over again, and finally you were able to get that fish off the hook. If he were here, he'd be so proud of you. Let's snap a picture and send it to Dad. And we did. And so it's a way of keeping memories and keeping the parent in the child's psyche in a positive way. And parents are responsible to do that for children. Withdrawal of love. So I like to tell stories with these, as you can tell, because otherwise I think they're just words on a screen and don't really convey the depth of pain to children and don't really convey the depth of cruelty of the parent. So one particular story I have about withdrawing love from, and the result is that the kids don't feel like they can talk about the other parent in the presence of one parent. And so I had a 12-year-old girl who was absolutely amazing. She still had contact with both her parents and was moving between her homes rather well. They'd been divorced for 10 years. They'd been in court 6 different times during those 10 years. And she was still doing okay. But Dad was pretty enraged. We didn't know exactly what at, but it clearly was about Mom. And Mom and daughter went on a spring break trip together, and she was telling me this in session, that she was so excited to see Dad. Couldn't wait. It had been 10 days, and she couldn't wait to see him again. So he pulled up in front of the house. She jumped, put her backpack on, and ran out the front door and jumped in the back seat, not realizing that she still had her Mexico t-shirt on from their trip. And she said that Dad turned around and looked at her and just said to her, "What the hell do you have on?" And then turned around and drove off. She was in tears when she told me this in my office. And she knew, she said to me, "I just cannot take anything from my mom to my dad." And she knew, there's no space there for me to love my mom openly when I'm with my dad. So again, a good example of withdrawal of love. He didn't say, "I don't love you," but his words certainly said, "I'm not going to love you if you talk positively about her." Telling the child that the other parent doesn't love him or her is, again, something that's usually done through events. It can be direct, "he or she doesn't love you," but it's usually a little more subtle than that. So I had a 8-year-old boy who told me he knew why his parents had gotten divorced, because his mom just wanted to go out and party. And he was standing at the window when he was a really little kid, and he was waving at her, and he was crying, and she turned around and looked at him, and then she kept walking, and I said, "How old were you when that happened?" And he said, "Oh, I was about 3. And I said, "Wow, you remember that from being 3 years old?" And he said, "No, my dad told me that because he needed to explain to me why they weren't married anymore." Again, I have to ask myself, what kind of parent would want their child to think that the other parent didn't love them? Even if that were a true story, which it was not, who would want to convey that? I would be thinking, "Oh, I hope he never remembers that day. That was a really bad parenting day for Mom or Dad." I wouldn't relish in my child knowing something like that or feeling unloved by their other parent. Forcing a child to choose is giving them an ultimatum in many different ways, that if they're going to love their mother or their dad, they can't be loved by them. If they're going to celebrate a birthday with the other parent, they don't need 2 birthdays, so we're not going to celebrate here. There are just many different small events that will happen where a child gets the message over and over and over again that you must choose one or the other. You can't have us both. Creating the impression that the targeted parent is dangerous. This can be false allegations. This can be stories about the child when they were very little. Usually those stories are embellished somewhat, or they are missing significant information. The case of a little girl who's afraid to go spend the night with her dad because her mom has told her that dad never woke up at night to take care of her during the night. She would have bad dreams, and Mom told her she was the only one who went and comforted her. Mom didn't tell her that when she was born, Dad had a job where he had to work the night shift and he wasn't even there. So again, significant details that are left out to convey a message that the child's not going to be okay at the other home. Withholding medical and academic information, this is a way to marginalize parents. Children begin to see that there's only one parent really knowing what's going on with them. They go to the school to have lunch with their child, and they find out they haven't been listed on the enrollment paperwork. The school staff says to them, "I'm sorry, you can't have lunch with your kid because you're not on here. We don't know you're a parent, so you need to go get your divorce decree, send it into the legal department. We'll let you know when you're on the enrollment forms, and then you can have lunch with your kids." It's a very humiliating experience for parents. Cultivating independency is just about enmeshed, unhealthy relationships where children can't leave parents because they're afraid the parent can't survive, and children who can't leave parents because they're afraid they can't survive without that parent. It looks something like this in the hierarchy, which is the unhealthiness of an alienation hierarchy, where you have a parent and a child on equal terms, and you have a disempowered, rejected parent or targeted parent. And then the other way it can look, we usually with an older teenager, is the child's running the show everywhere. A normal family hierarchy looks more like this, even when the parents are divorced. Two parents can still be on the same page, two parents can still be talking about important things that have to do with the child, and the child knows, my parents are talking, so I really can't get away with anything, and they're sharing information about me. So oftentimes, it is when I go to conceptualize a case of parental alienation, I need to describe to either lawyers or to parents, maybe both, and to the judge, how this alienation took hold. Sometimes the best description is to go through some of those specific behaviors that we just went through and to say, this is how it presented itself. This is when these behaviors started. However, there are times when we have an established social psychological theory that captures the dynamics of the family better than going through individual behaviors. Domestic violence dynamics are is a case in point. Jennifer Harmon and her colleagues have shown how methods of psychological aggression used in intimate partner violence can produce an alienation response in a child. I wanted to show how a few of these aggressive techniques do overlap with the individual behaviors that we spoke about just a minute ago, but some of them don't, which is why when this particular dynamic is going on in a family, and usually what I find is that it was going on before the divorce, it continues afterwards as a way to control the children and control the other parent. And this is not gender specific. So sometimes when I use the word domestic violence, it immediately conjures up thoughts that men are the ones doing this. In alienation, there is no gender differences. Men are alienated as much as women, and men are alienators as much as women. So forms of psychological aggression, I have had cases when it is it is enacted by a man and a woman. And then the last thing I want to talk about in terms of another social psychological theory that is useful to use whenever it applies to a particular family dynamic is the work that Clower and Rivlin have done. They wrote a book called Children Held Hostage. The book was published by the American Bar Association. Their first study was in 1991. It involved 700 cases of children who had gone through divorce. In 2013, they came out with a second edition. They added three more cases to their study. Basically, they identified 8 stages of brainwashing and about 11 or 12 different brainwashing techniques. The key to this theory is that there is a program enacted by the alienating parent, and that program, the techniques are used to support that program. One program that I have heard quite frequently is he or she abandoned us. And so every other technique that is used to support that program that's being inculcated into the child. And just in case that sounds like it's not possible, I was going to talk about a few, but I'm short on time. So this is what they came with. They said, after 20 years, we know these things, more than this, but these were three that stood out to me. We know that a child can be manipulated to reject a once-loved parent. We know that traditional therapies do not work. An hour in a family therapy office is not going to help an alienated child, but that is a whole nother lecture. And that this form of social psychological child abuse is likely to be as damaging as physical abuse. And just in case that seems a little bit hard to believe, I want to remind you of, sorry, I keep going the wrong way, this recent NBC Dateline show where this 19-year-old was convinced by her father to help murder her mom. And her statement to a friend when she was in jail and she knew Dad was in jail, my mother wouldn't know what to do right now. She would know how to help me. The reason that's significant to me is that working with severely alienated children, when they are removed from the alienated parent and they are put with the parent that they say they despise, the parent they say that if I have to see that parent, I'm going to kill myself, within about 3 days, that hatred drops and the original attachment to the parent resurfaces, as long as they know they're not going back to the alienating, psychologically abusive parent. They will drop all of that hatred. It's not to say that they will not have tons of psychological work in front of them to deal with the guilt, but we will see the original attachment resurface fairly quickly. So, thank you for your time today. Oh, question? I didn't think we had time. Okay.
I believe this probably is a whole other lecture. Do you have a quick summary as to how you can overcome some of those situations?
A quick summary to overcome a situation where there's alienation?
I guess maybe techniques on how to comfort them, how to make them feel comfortable once they're away from the parent who is alienating the child from the other parents.
Once they are placed with the parent that they've been rejecting, is that what you mean? Working, yeah, that's the key. That parent, if they've been working with a mental health professional, will have obtained their own support and guidance as to how to interact with the child initially when the child comes back. And really, it's a combination of very empathic, reflecting of their feelings, acknowledging their feelings, and staying very very centered with them. What I mean by that is you're staying current. You're not really talking about the past. You're saying, understand how you feel. Understand it must be hard on you. But we're going to get through this. We can do this. I know we can. And then they are surrounded usually by a mental health team that's helping them through that process.
You mentioned that parental alienation is psychological child abuse. If it's child abuse, should that be something that would be that a mandated reporter should report?
I think that it should be reported as psychological and emotional abuse. What I've found is that we may need to educate our family service departments, our child protective service caseworkers, so that they understand what it is they're seeing when they get one of these reports.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Hey, George. Well, I agree with that. The family code states emotional and mental before physical under child abuse. And I have called CPS before, and it seems like that they're only worried about the physical, not the emotional and mental.
I agree. I've called CPS before also.
I know Senator Menendez is putting together a blue ribbon bill for child abuse, and I've thought about it, you know, trying to slide this in, you know, some sort of legislation to address this and maybe fly under the radar into this blue ribbon bill. But it's what is being done legislatively with PA. I mean, is there anything on the books right now? Because I'm on the 2503 movement, and I don't really, I know about PA, but I'm not well versed in it.
I don't know that I can answer that question. I don't know that anything is being done legislatively. I don't know, Jeff, do you know
about
that? I don't. I think
most states have a part of their law on custody and parenting time being that each parent is supposed to promote the good relationship between the child and the other parent. To the extent that that is enforced, of course, that's an issue, but that certainly exists in a lot of state statutes.
Sure, yeah. And I do believe that before people can take it on as an issue, they really have to understand it. So again, every time that you get a chance to describe parental alienation, I think that that's an opportunity to somehow make a difference.
I guess what I'm saying is that it's recognized in the family code as mental and emotional, but what other forms of mental and emotional are there besides parental alienation that can be done to a child? Because it's obviously stated in the statute, but nobody recognizes emotional or mental anything. It's all physical. Everything mm-hmm. comes down to physical. And
correct.
Just.
Yeah, it's just a challenge. It's just a challenge to bring the awareness up and, like I said, to educate people.
Thank you.
Okay.